When AC/DC frontman Bon Scott sang "Let There Be Light, Let There Be Sound, Let There Be Rock" in the mid-70s, he knew from his then quite extensive background as an Australian pop vocalist that it was usually a case of one out of three, if you were lucky. In the 50s and early 60s, a hot hit band, like say Cold Joy and the Joy Boys, would go out on a national tour with gear and musicians all neatly contained in a single station wagon. When the Beatles toured Down Under in the middle of 1964, they played to howling hordes under production conditions so primitive that they can scarce be believed nowadays. At Sydney Stadium, devoted Fab Four fans heard them sing through four clusters of three tiny tin speakers, usually used for boxing announcements. The dozen tinny old horns were powered by a 100-watt amplifier with two knobs on it. The three guitarists used 60-watt Vox amps. Ringo's drums were left to fend for themselves. It would be reasonable to say that your home stereo has more power these days than that which met the needs of 13,000 screaming fans per show in the old tin shed. Now, more than 35 years on, when we attend concerts or any live show, we automatically expect dazzling light and sound. Even unknown pub bands deliver production qualities that the Beatles or Cole or JOK or the Easy Beats could only have dreamed of. The evolution has been truly astonishing, and that's what is being honoured right here, right now. Over a couple of decades, a cottage industry became an international force with enormous leaps in technology and expertise, thanks to the tireless efforts of Australian equipment manufacturers whose innovations have been followed throughout the world. In 1976, I conceived and managed a band called Old 55, which debuted with a triple platinum album. We found ourselves on stages and wild tours alongside the likes of Sherbet, Skyhooks and AC/DC, and on the road with a wonderful menagerie of luminous characters with names like The Pig, The Bear and Swampy. So 5 years on, when legendary rock photographer Bob King and myself put together this book, Rock Lens, I called on those memories and included a section called Bands Make It Rock, But Roadies Make It Roll. Here's a little of what I wrote then. A roadie is a rare and unique species of humanity. He can exist with no more than 4 hours sleep per day, and often less, repair a suddenly silent sound system in the dark, armed with just a wobbly flashlight and a roll of gaff tape, persuade a huge lorry to perform ludicrous feats, dismantle an entire stage rig in less time than it takes the performers to change their costumes, neatly dispose of all troublesome caretakers, jealous boyfriends and complaining residents, and insist that he wouldn't be happy doing anything else. Australian rock is fortunate to have the services of some of the world's finest roadies. Eccentric, cynical, and usually off their faces, most possess the proverbial heart of gold behind some particularly menacing exteriors. End of quote. What you're about to see are slices of Oz rock in its glory days, in pubs, halls, and outdoor festivals. But instead of looking at it entirely as a display of performing talent, I'd ask you to take in what else is standing and happening on those stages. The lighting rigs, the speaker stacks, the often elaborate props, and those ragged lads skittering all over the place, holding it together and making it happen. They are the true unsung heroes of rock, and I'm proud to have known some of the best.
Yeah. because I'm good in bed. Just fine because I'm good in bed. Yeah, that's what your girlfriend said. You just like me because I keep you some head. You just like me because I'm good in bed.